All right, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. Today we're going to answer you guys' questions. I love doing Q&A sessions. It's super simple, super easy. I don't got to film any DIY stuff or anything. Just got to talk to you guys, and I love doing that. So the first thing I want to state is that I apologize in advance. I cannot answer all the emails, all the Facebook messages, all the YouTube messages, all the stuff I get. I have far too little time to do everything I want to do in life, and I have to set priorities. It's quite unfortunate. My priorities are, you know, making a living, and making my garden videos, and you know, actually gardening and really doing this stuff. Actually, I'm here in the backyard, and pretty much everything that everything growing in here, I planted with my own two hands, or nature's planted by plants going to seed, drop in seeds, and then come up. And so it does take a good amount of time. And as much as I would love to answer everybody's question and ensure that they have the answers they need, I'm not able to do it at this time, you know, and dedicate my time to do that. But I will answer questions in videos like this. So if you do have a question you would like to get in a video like this, you can post it on my YouTube discussion page, which you can get to by going to growingyourgreens.com. Click the discussion tab. You could enter a question there. You could also go under about, and then you could actually send me a private message to get a question to me that way. Once again, you know, it may end up in a, you know, Q&A session like this. Now, if you do have a question you need to get answered by me and you do want to talk to me, I also have a way you guys could do that. It's my Fiverr campaign. I'll put a link down below this video. What the Fiverr campaign does basically is Fiverr collects $5 from you. Of that, I get $4. And of the $4, I don't see a penny of that. That goes back directly into the Fiverr community, that I pay other people in the Fiverr community to transcribe my videos so that my videos that are me speaking can now get into a transcription so that you could get closed captioning for people that may not be able to hear, or more importantly, for people that are in different countries and do not understand English that well. Actually, Google or YouTube has automatic translations into other foreign languages. So once again, that's only $5. That's for a 10-minute consultation session with me. I'm able to do it right now because it's a low volume. If it gets to be a lot, I may have to take it away and stuff. But I enjoy reaching out and talking to some people and answering questions to the best of my ability. I may not have an answer to everything, but I am quite opinionated and do have a lot of experience in gardening. So before we get into today's questions, I have a special announcement. And if you're not following me already on Facebook, you could follow me on Facebook. I do post things on Facebook that are not actually posted onto my gardening channel videos. Also, I did start an Instagram account. You want to check me out there at instagram.com/growingyourgreens, where you'll see a lot of you know, behind the scenes footage sometimes of what I'm growing in the garden, what I'm doing in the garden, you know, what some of my plants look like, what I'm eating, all this kind of cool stuff. instagram.com/growingyourgreens. Anyways, on Facebook, about a month ago, I posted that the Boogie Brew company is having a victory garden contest. They're doing a monthly contest, so they will have, you know, one winner a month for the next year. And what they're doing is they're trying to help people and encourage people to grow victory gardens and show people examples of what people using the Boogie Brew products are getting in their very gardens. So basically, they've requested people send in pictures. People have done that for the entire month, and now they've chosen a winner for this month. And the winner of this month and future months get the Boogie Brew Pro Brew Kit, which is over $100 value with the Boogie Brew and all the different Boogie products to ensure your plants are going to dance and be as healthy as possible. So it's kind of cool for me to see people using the Boogie Brew products in their garden and getting similar results to what I'm getting. I mean, I'm nothing special. I use the Boogie Brew products. I use some of the products that I showed you guys, and I get the results. And if you want the results, maybe you might want to try the products. And if you don't want the results and don't want to spend the money, that's cool too. I don't care. My main message is to grow your own food and eat it despite the products. But personally for me, I want to grow the highest quality food, you know, the most nutrition with the most resilient plants. Because think about it. I mean, my neighbors here in town or their fellow gardeners are growing through the summer heat in Las Vegas, 110 plus degrees. Last 2 weeks, it's almost been 100, over 100 every single day. And you know, their plants will shut down at certain periods of time when they get too stressed out because they don't have the nutrition in the soil that they, you know, that I have. They're not using the special irrigation system that's oxygenating the root zone, which makes the plants more resilient, you know, to the extreme heat you know, they're not using the Boogie Brew products to incorporate nutrition into the plants and, more importantly, the microbes that helps the plant's immune system, which basically all these items combined allows you to have healthier plants. Now, when you have healthier plants, it's not rocket science. Your plants are more resistant to stress, disease, pests, inclement weather, hot weather, and will still continue to produce for you. The problem is when your plants get stressed out because you don't have the right nutrition in the soil, you know, you're using NPK fertilizer when there's other nutrients that your plants may need, when you don't have the microbes in there, they get stressed out and they can't cope and they shut down, they don't produce anymore. And this is kind of like us. I want us to be as healthy as possible by eating a wide variety of plant-based foods, you know, predominantly. It's quite sad that in America, people are eating processed foods. And I look at, you know, chemical fertilizers as processed foods for your plants. Why do that? You know, why not feed your plants the natural foods? And that's what I want all of us as people to do, eat natural foods so we'll have optimal health, be more resilient to things going on in our lives, just like, you know, the model I show in the plants. And that's what the, you know, the Boogie Brew products allow you to do in a one-stop shop. They provide all the different products that allow you to do that. Anyways, this month's winner is Adam Rasmussen. Congratulations, Adam. Your garden looks amazing. Some of the pictures you posted, I mean, super amazing. And Adam also tagged Jennifer Castro, I guess. And Boogie Brew is also gonna send Jennifer, because Adam tagged her, back to the July special package deal, which includes the Boogie Humus, which I like so much, which is basically wood chip compost. That actually, I'm gonna have some questions in the Q&A. So be sure to check out Boogie Brew on Facebook. They will be accepting entries for next month, and maybe you'll be announced on my show next month as next month's winner. Anyways, without further ado, let's get into today's questions. The first question is from Tim Westner. I started watching your channel in March 2014. I've tried a lot of the products you recommend, and it's the best results I've ever had. Anyway, can you do an episode on indoor gardening, the difference between light types, spectrums, etc.? I live in PA, so I would have to grow indoors in the winter. I would just like to know how to get good results. I appreciate the videos and can't wait for more. All right, Tim, so I gotta be the first to say, you know, while I do grow outside year-round and I've grown indoors a little bit, I'm by no means an expert indoor gardener. I have visited many places that do grow indoors, and in some cases I have shared the exact lighting they are using so that you guys will know what the experts or the pros are using to get results. Now, the thing is, if I lived in Pennsylvania in the wintertime, I would focus on the microgreens and the sprouts. I have an excellent episode where I went to a place that grows microgreens commercially indoors, and I share exactly the lighting they use and the fixtures they use and where they get them. So I would recommend you guys watch that video if you're interested in growing indoors. Microgreens and sprouts, number one thing to grow in the winter no matter where you live. You could actually produce a consistent supply of it to supplement your diet, the really important leafy greens that I recommend. You know, to me, it probably wouldn't be worth the ton of energy it would use to, you know, grow some cherry tomatoes just so I could have them in the winter time. What I would prefer to do instead is grow a ton of cherry tomatoes and extra tomatoes outside my summer garden and dehydrate them so that I could be eating out of my garden in the winter time. I have another question later on in this Q&A regarding growing in the winter with more of, you know, my opinions on this subject. But yes, I will try to make it a point to visit a hydroponic shop or something in the future to go over the lighting, the spectrums, and the power needed, because that's very important. I mean, I wouldn't use the same lighting to grow the microgreens that I would to get tomatoes or fruit in the wintertime. That'd just be ludicrous. All right. Anyways, next question. Adam Shiminski. Hi, John. I was wondering your opinion on restaurant food waste that goes down the drain and is caught in a trap before it goes into the sewer that has been separated from the grease, composted, and heat treated. It smells like urine and has a consistency of peat moss. The bright side is it's only $25 for 2 yards. The man there assured me there is no human excrement in the compost. I've watched your episodes on biosludge. I'm hoping this is something different and usable with my fruits and veggies. P.S. Love your show. It has been a big inspiration. Looking forward to your input. All right, Adam. So if a compost smells like urine, I wouldn't use it personally. I mean, I did get a batch of compost from A1 Organics in Las Vegas, Nevada, which they actually made me take down my video and it smelled really bad. And I even after getting it, letting it sit for 8 months, it still smelled bad. So what I had to do is actually I put it on the bottom of these raised beds, just like that much, to put it all the way on the bottom. And then I layered other good compost on top that did not smell. That just concerns me. I mean, a compost to me should not smell. I think the problem with that is that even though they say they're removing the oil, there's still a lot of oil and potentially other things in there that are not decomposing down, that would decompose in nature if they weren't using potentially food additives or whatever else. I don't know what they're putting in there. So for me personally, I would steer clear of that stuff. Now, if that's the only stuff you got, or you're going to use that or Miracle Craft fertilizer, you know, I'd probably choose this. But that being said, I would source another form of compost locally produced in your area using, you know, even wood chips and food scraps and yard waste before I use this grease composted restaurant sludge stuff. That's just my opinion on that. Not to say that it wouldn't work, but I would be highly wary, especially, you know, just because it's cheap doesn't make it good, right? In general, you know, you get what you pay for. And I'll just leave it at that. That's just my two cents. Next question is from E. Kenny and Linda. Now that I have government permission to grow weed here in Washington State, what's a good online source you would recommend? I can grow anything I put my mind to. This will be no different. Thanks in advance for the info. All right, so by weed, I don't think you mean like edible weed such as dandelions and stinging nettles. I think you mean medicinal herbs such as marijuana. Recently, in both Colorado and Washington State, they've actually approved growing medicinal herbs or marijuana legally. And, you know, I don't really have any online resources I can recommend. What I would recommend is this. I would recommend you watch my videos that I make, because I'm growing herbs. Many of them are actually medicinal, but not that kind. And many of them are also quite edible and delicious, as well as other vegetables. And all plants have a lot of things in common, right? They all like good nutrition. They all like mineral-rich soil. They all like, you know, microbial populations in the soil, all this kind of stuff. So if you watch my videos, you learn my gardening style that can be applied to growing medicinal herbs, no matter what kind they are, whether legal or illegal, wherever you live, but also the vegetables. And you'll have the highest amount of, you know, yields. You'll have higher, you know, oil contents, or, you know, resin contents, whatever content you're looking for, higher antioxidant contents, higher vitamin contents, higher mineral contents, by doing some of the practices. You know, I don't advocate myself being a cheap, frugal gardener. While I do many frugal things and try to save the most money as I can, you know, I'm after having the highest quality, the most yield, most production, and healthiest plants so that I can eat them and get the benefits from them. And so that's my whole shtick, you know, in a nutshell. And of course, yeah, if you want to follow some of the things I do, great. And if you don't, that's cool too. And you might not agree with everything I do, and that's cool too, because everybody has their own ideas and opinions about things, and I'm not here to say mine's right or wrong. This is just what I do and what I believe in at present time, which also may change. And I've changed some of the things and some of the practices I've done, you know, over the years as well. So yeah, so that's what I'd say to you. And oh, the other thing is, I hope to get out to Washington State or Colorado really soon and get a good and visit a good grow op. And, you know, really go inside the grow op and share with you, you know, what they're doing and how to do it, you know. So that's gonna be fun for me too, to learn about that stuff. And, you know, I think that medicinal herbs should be legalized everywhere in the country. So the next question is from Papa Bob. Hi, John. Watched a number of your videos regarding the use of rock dust. In one of them, you and your best speaker said to add rock dust into the soil and cultivate it in about 4 inches. As I learn about this, my plants are fairly well established already, and I have done sections of my garden with wood chips this year. The problem question is, how would I use the rock dust in these two conditions? If I try to cultivate in the rock dust around my standing plants, I may do more harm digging around the roots than provide an advantage. Same questions where I have the wood chips. Can I simply put some rock dust on the top of the soil chips around the plants and water it in for the season? All right, Papa Bob, so my answer is this. You know, if you do not want to disturb the roots, I mean, it's like, take some of these plants here, I could easily scratch around, and yeah, I wouldn't scratch down 4 inches. I might scratch down an eighth or a quarter inch, scratch a little bit of soil down and sprinkle some, you know, rock dust in there, and then put the soil back on top, and then, yeah, water it in. That's surely one method to do it. Another method I have used actually in my pepper bed, actually, because it still sank down because it's a newly filled bed. I actually just made a mixture of rock dust with compost and then just layered it on top of the soil, you know, which will then also filter down. Another way I would do, instead of just sprinkling rock dust on and then watering in, because it can't have a problem of clumping and whatnot, I'll just actually put it in like a big 5-gallon bucket, fill it with water with the rock dust, make a nice mixture, and then use that watering mixture in a watering can or backpack sprayer to spray it on, you know, onto the soil, all around the plants and all this kind of stuff, you know, to get it to where it needs to be. There's no reason you should wait to apply it for next year, but of course next year, when next year rolls around, apply it in your soil before planting your plants out. That'd be my best and recommended way. But I'm gonna soon go over to my brother's house, who has trees he's never fertilized, never done anything to, and I'm gonna apply the rock dust, and I'll share with you guys how I'm gonna do that in that episode. All right, next question from Thomas Mears. John, your video on wood chips and rock dust, you speak about how they inoculated with mushroom spores, but you skim over it so quickly after watching it 4 times. I don't think you actually said, although I did hear mycorrhizae mentioned. Were there other fungal strains in the pound of spores? Of course, this question surely shows my ignorance. I'm sure there are others that would like you to mention the subject as well. So yes, I believe in that episode I did ask the owner of the garden, or the steward of the garden there, what kind of mushrooms she inoculated her wood chips with, and they were the King Stratifaria mushrooms. And so, let's see, those are like alternatives to like portobellos. They're also known as wine cap mushrooms. So yeah, do a Google search on wine cap mushroom spores or King Stratifaria, and then you can find some spores, and then those are the ones you're gonna wanna use. Now, there are other ones that work, but this is like the one that's mostly commonly used when decomposing wood chips, because they really go crazy, and also they produce an edible shroom for you to eat. All right, next question is from Chelsea Hugh. I'm currently a college student at Florida International University in Miami, Florida. I graduate in December with a major in English, but I'm very passionate about edible gardening, and I've recently started my own personal one at home. Any advice on how to get a career in this field, edible gardening? Any internships you know of? Thank you, Chelsea Hugh. All right, Chelsea, so, you know, I was in college once, I graduated once, and I came out with my degree, and then actually I didn't even get a job in my field that I went to school for, but nonetheless, I think college can be valuable in some instances. But in edible gardening, most of the time, in my opinion, it's better just to do it and learn by your experiences. You'll learn far more, and especially watching my videos, in my opinion, than even going to school for this kind of stuff. Now, as to a career, I always want to encourage everybody out there, you and everybody else watching, is I want to encourage you guys not to think about a career as like going and finding a job in this industry, because that never pays you guys for what you guys are truly worth. You guys are truly more than just getting paid an hourly rate at a job, you know, even if you like it. You know, I want to encourage everybody out there to be their own boss, you know, learn how you can make a career out of doing something you love and you working for yourself. If everybody provided a job for themselves in America, like if everybody provided food for themselves in America, the world would be a different place. You know, in my opinion, the system is making people dependent on finding a job, on buying food, when we should be truly independent. I mean, we just celebrated Independence Day, and I want to encourage everybody to be independent in their food choices, you know, and in their job choices as much as they can. And I understand, I'm not saying quit your job tomorrow and be independent, but on the side, have something going, have plans for what you want to do on your own, so that one day you could leave your job, do what you truly love, make a career out of it, whether it's edible gardening or whether it's something else. So for you, as to edible gardening, since you're right out of college, probably the main thing is you may not want to know what you want to do in the edible gardening field yet, whether that means owning your own farm, producing produce, whether you want to have your own microgreens company produce microgreens and do retail or restaurant sales, whether that means starting baby plant starts and selling them, you know, in the season to people, whether that means, you know, raising rare and exotic, you know, edible perennial greens and vegetables that people can't get, like the tree collards or like the yacone or like the sunchokes and some of the things that I talk about that you just can't buy at nurseries. You know, whether that means having a edible garden blog, I mean, that could be your career. I mean, I could turn making videos into gardening my career. It's not my career. I do this for fun. But that could be your career as well, depending on, you know, where you live, how much money you need, and all this kind of stuff. I mean, people do and are successful at that. And yeah, you're an English writer, so don't correct my English, because I'm not an English writer. But yeah, so there's many things and many aspects you can take in this whole edible gardening, you know, career path. Now, as to internships, I don't know of any internships at present time. I mean, I would encourage you to, if you see some of the videos or some of the places I visit, if you like some of those places, reach out to them and ask them if they have any internships available. Another thing I wanted to mention is that I will have an internship available soon to help me in my garden to take care of things and take me to the next level, you know, because me alone with one assistant can only go so far to get this message out and all the work that I want to do, and I just can't literally do it all. There's so many things in the garden that I can't even get to every day. So yes, I do need some help, and if you are interested in interning with me particularly, you can send me a message over the YouTube email system and tell me more about yourself and, you know, why you like an internship and what you expect to learn, and I could see if that would, you know, I could meet some of those needs. Yeah, so that's pretty much it. So now we're down to the last question. It's from Hal337. Question, top best crops for feeding yourself. What plants would you suggest to someone who wants to produce as much of the mass from their garden as easily as possible to feed themselves the most? Some crops that produce a lot, perhaps different ones for winter, summer. How do I feed myself consistently? Thank you. Your work is vital for our long-term survival. All right, Hal. So, you know, my answer to this question would be different depending on where in the country I lived. For example, if I lived in South Florida, you know, where there's an easily tropical environment with year-round growing, I would grow up a lot of perennial, edible, tropical, leafy green vegetables, such as I go to this place in Echo in Fort Myers to share with you guys. You know, that's probably what I'd do. I'd grow a lot of edible perennial vegetables. I'd also grow a lot of fruit trees because they will fruit year-round. I'd select different varieties of fruit trees that will go off in different months, so I could have different fruits every single month of the year in South Florida. If I lived somewhere like Northern California, you know, where I could grow year-round, I would plant things seasonally that would grow year-round in their proper season, and that would do well for me. Of course, I would also add fruit trees in, nut trees, you know, also lots of vegetables, tubers, roots. I mean, just basically planting a variety, because the other thing you want to remember, if you think, oh, John said plant potatoes, I would never say that. But John said plant potatoes because you could get a lot of harvest and you could store them all year and eat those all year, and you could live on potatoes like they do in South America. And you could do that. But what if you had tomato blight or some kind of crop failure? Then all your potatoes are literally in one basket and then you're not eating. So I really want to encourage you guys, no matter where you live, no matter what top crops somebody may say, you want to diversify and grow a range of them. So yeah. You know, don't just grow one thing, grow a number of different things so that all your eggs are not in one basket. This will also be very important for survival, especially with, you know, the weather being all weird and hot weather, cold weather, and hotter hot, colder cold. And, you know, some of the plants may not perform as well as they used to. And some of the new plants they even experiment with may even do better. So the last way that I would grow food, say if I was in a more northern climate like Pennsylvania, like one of the viewers earlier that asked the question, you know, I do a whole different scheme of things, you know, because I couldn't grow reliably and a lot in the winter. I would grow things like a lot of pumpkins, sweet potatoes, and squashes that could be stored all summer long. So, I mean, I've seen pumpkins literally 1,000 pounds large. That'll feed you for a long time. I don't know that I want to grow pumpkins 1,000 pounds, you know, because that's a lot of pumpkin to deal with, but I would love to grow I'd rather grow 100 10-pound pumpkins that, you know, you could eat one every couple days and they're gonna store throughout the whole winter. I would also grow things like tuberous root crops that can be stored in a cold cellar or just be kept in the ground outside and dig them up as you need them. So some of my favorite ones for production, sunchokes, number one by far. I mean, that thing grows like a weed. It'll take over as a weed, which I think is a good thing and provide you a lot of food to eat. You know, of course, I'd grow also things like, depending on where you live and how the weather was, sweet potatoes. I really like some of the hard squashes, such as the butternut squashes, the kabocha squash, you know, some of those really good storable, you know, winter squashes. I mean, if you're looking for seeds, check out Baker Creek Heirloom Seed Company at rareseeds.com. I mean, I went to an heirloom expo where they had over 100 varieties and even more of different winter squashes. I'm sure they all taste different, and each of them may perform better or worse in your specific climate, your specific area. So you want to start experimenting with different ones and see which ones are most productive for you. Because, yeah, I could make you recommendations. Oh, yeah, grow this one, but it does good for me, but it won't do good in your specific climate. So, yeah, winter squashes and tubers is probably some of the big carbohydrate-rich foods that I'd want to eat in a northern climate. Now, carbohydrate-rich foods in a, you know, southern climate, tropical climate would be my fruits. So really, what we want to focus on when looking at long-term survival is we want a few things. Number one, we want like a good carbohydrate source, number one. Number two, we want a good fat source. So fat sources could be growing like sunflower seeds in, you know, in a summer season to store for the winter time. Depending on where you live, you could grow nut trees and the nut store over the winter, no problem. And that's another good food storage. Has a lot of calories and energy in that stored food that'll be stored through the winter for you, besides the squashes and the carbohydrates. And then the third category that I'd really need you guys to focus on, because people just focus on carbohydrates or fats, you know, which are important. But the other thing for me are highly nutritious foods. I mean, my channel is called Growing Your Greens. Growing Your Greens is for a reason. Greens are the most nutritious foods on the planet. I will challenge anybody this, they will lose. They have the most nutrition, the most amount of phytochemicals, phytonutrients, vitamins, and minerals compared to calories, compared to any other food on the planet. It's, in my opinion, the greens are the most healing foods and really are providing Americans in this day and age what they're lacking. People are eating fast food, junk foods, which are high in fat and calories, which are good, you know, for survival when you're eating them whole and plant-based, such as sunchokes or, you know, squashes or sunflower seeds, but not good in their highly processed state. But most Americans are eating high calorie and fat foods with low nutrition. And that's why greens are the most important thing. I mean, for me, especially in the wintertime, no matter where you live, anywhere in the world, you can grow microgreens inside your house and have consistent, reliable, bug and disease-free production all winter long. All summer long, for that matter. You could be producing like one tray a day, you know, to eat, to have huge, bountiful salads that you grew with your very own hands, which are cheaper than buying salad greens in a store, and also way more nutritious, because microgreens, I mean, they're like 4 to 40 times more nutritious than the larger greens. So micro kale, 4 to 40 times more nutritious than having, you know, large kale leaves. So that'd be my number one survival food, is the microgreens. You could store tons of seeds, have enough water and equipment to grow your own food and literally make food out of the seeds. So yeah, that's by far the most important thing. And of course, you know, depending on where you live, in the wintertime, I would grow tons of greens. Leafy greenage, super important to me. You know, the brassica crops tend to do very well. And even if I was in a northern climate, I would put up hoop houses and even double hoop houses and use the four seasons gardening method and be able to grow outside all winter long. So, you know, all of these elements need to be taken into consideration to make a viable, you know, food survival plan for the long term, and just basically doing it now so that you could be eating all the food you're growing. And then in case shit hits the fan, you can be prepared for that day, because you're already going to be growing the stuff every year. You're going to have surplus every year. You're going to be having the greens all the time. You're going to be having the microgreen production up. You're going to be an expert at it. You can do it with your eyes shut. And then when shit hits the fan, let me know, because I'll come to your house just in case as my backup plan. All right. So that's pretty much the end of this episode. Hope you guys enjoyed this Q&A. Be sure to subscribe to my videos if you're not already. I have over 950 videos now exploring all different avenues of growing your own food, visiting places that, you know, grow food, how they do it, a lot of Q&A sessions like this, and how to just set up, and how-to videos on how to set up this in your garden, on your patio, if you want to. Hope you guys enjoyed this episode. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and remember, keep on growing.
All right, this is Joe Ancola with growingyourgreens.com. Today I have another exciting episode for you, and we're on another field trip here. We're here in Las Vegas, Nevada, and as you guys can see, most front yards in Vegas are kind of like this, just rocked in, and there's a number of yards, mostly rocked.